Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, committee members. My name is Erika Thompson, and I'm here today on behalf of myself and the bees and beekeepers of Texas to show my support for HB 520. I'm a proud native Texan, a full-time professional beekeeper, and the founder and owner of Texas Bee Works. I started keeping bees like many people do, with one hive in my backyard here in Central Austin. And now I have my own beekeeping business and over 150 hives across 5 counties in Central Texas. I also run a popular beekeeping social media account where I have over 4 million followers turning to me here in Texas to learn about the important work that bees and beekeepers do every day. And the question I get asked the most is, how often do you get stung? And usually the simple answer to that is that most bees are gentle and docile and don't want to sting you. And that question is usually followed quickly by, what can we do to help the bees? And my answer to that is always the same. The most important thing that anybody can do if they want to help bees and pollinators is to plant pollinator-friendly plants. And one of the most important things that the great state of Texas can do for bees is to pass HB 520. There are over 20,000 species of bees in the world, and over 800 of those call Texas home. When we develop land for agriculture, infrastructure, and human settlement, bees lose the native vegetation that they rely on for food and for shelter. And if their habitats aren't destroyed completely by human development, these spaces are broken up in ways that aren't large enough to meet the needs of the existing pollinator populations. And that fragmentation forces the bees of Texas to work even harder to survive our often unpredictable weather. Establishing and maintaining pollinator pathways is essential to the survival of Texas bees, perhaps now more than ever. As a full-time beekeeper who works bees almost every day, I've seen the effects of habitat loss firsthand. And in the past 6 weeks, I've seen colony loss due to starvation more than I've ever seen in my 10 years of being a beekeeper and more than I ever hoped to see again. When epic winter storms and prolonged freezing temperatures hit Texas last month, like many of us, the bees were simply not prepared. And many colonies died. But it wasn't the freezing temperatures themselves that led to the widespread loss. Most colonies were lost because of starvation. The bees did not have enough food collected and stored to sustain their entire colony, or they couldn't access the food they had, and they couldn't bring more food in. Many of you have never, and likely will never, experience what a starving colony of bees looks like, or feels like, or smells like. But for anyone who's ever kept bees and lost a colony due to starvation, we know that it's heartbreaking. A colony starves and dies inside of its hive, inside of its home. As a beekeeper, when you open a hive and find a colony that's died due to starvation, you just see thousands of little bee bodies with their heads facing forward in these honeycomb cells. And you realize that each bee died while searching for food in those cells and they never got out. It's devastating, but perhaps the worst part is that it's often avoidable. The most important thing I've learned as a professional beekeeper is to listen to the bees. The bees are telling us they need our help and they need us to support HB 520. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. I've read, you know, throughout my life is when the bees die, so do we. Members, any questions, Ms. Thompson? So I would tell you jokingly that if someone asks you how many times you've been stung and you answer bees are gentle, you should consider running for political office.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. Chair calls Luke Metzger.